Hello, this is Frank of the 12 Gates, and today we're going to be talking about 40 days, 40 nights, and even 40 years, and how it appears in the Bible, and what significance does the number 40 have? This is not a numerology sort of video, it's more based on the Bible, but it's just something I've noticed, and there's a lot of people have noticed this, but I mean, I'm just going to go into very quickly 40 days and 40 nights, and especially 40 years, and just try and find what the relevance of this is, because this comes up not a massive amount, but it comes up frequently enough for it to be noticed by quite a few people. We're going to be looking at bloodlines and how I think the bloodline, a certain bloodline, that seems to show up more often than anywhere else. Those people seem to be subjected to this 40 days, 40 nights and 40 years in some shape or form. And what we'll do is we'll try to come to a conclusion of what this relevance of this 40 years or 40 days and 40 nights is. And finally, what I'm going to do is it mentioned in the book of Revelation, the final book of the Bible? Is there any sort of mention at all of the number 40 or 40 days or 40 nights or 40 years? It's just something I've always wondered about, and you'll be surprised what actually comes up. And as always, as I say, this video is just my views, my opinions, my theories, and just generally kicking a few ideas around. And that's it. That's all it is. But what I'm coming up with here could be right, or it could be wrong, or it could be spot on, or it could be way off the mark. But it's just an interesting journey, looking at various verses and then seeing what comes out in the wash. Now, the first thing I always go through is the software, what we are using, and we are using the Xiphos software, and the version of the Bible we're using is the King James Version 1769, which is the KJVA, or the New King James Version. But there's not much difference between this and the 1611 version, which I've got in the hard copy as far as I can see. This is the main window here where the Bible verse under consideration is being looked at. If it's highlighted in green, that's the verse we're looking at. It may be also highlighted, maybe if there's more than one verse, it may be highlighted in yellow. Now, the next thing we'll do is look at this window here, which is the Treasury of Scripture Knowledge, and this gives, sometimes it gives at the beginning a brief rundown of what the chapter is all about. There we go, it's all there. And then what happens is the cross references, they come up in this window as well. And basically, if there's letters in front, then it's a different book. If it's just numbers like this one here, then it relates to this book here. And this is the book we're in, and that's the chapter, and that's the verse. These are the verses that are under consideration. And then if I click on this, the cross references, they get blown up. So you can see it's Genesis, Deuteronomy. Down here is Strong's, it's these numbers here. And these are basically Greek or Hebrew interpretations of the words, going into detail of the alternative meanings for these words. And also, if you click on there, it comes up here and gives you more information there as well. And that is basically the software. Yeah, so what we're going to do is have a look at a couple of examples of 40 years and just see the relevance of it. And I'm going to start off with, we'll go into 1 Kings, this is the Old Testament, and we've got two names here that come up, and they both have the number 40 associated with them. The first one is David. Let's read this verse. This is 1 Kings 2:11. And the days that David reigned over Israel were 40 years. 7 years reigned he in Hebron, and 33 years reigned he in Israel. He reigned for 40 years. Well, you think, okay, he reigned for 40 years. You know, it could have been 39 or 41. He reigned for 40. It's just a coincidence, isn't it? But let's just read the next verse. This is, I think he's on his deathbed here. And this is his son Solomon. Then sat Solomon upon the throne of David his father. So he obviously has died. And his kingdom was established greatly. Yeah, so Solomon takes over. Now if we go to 1 Kings 11:42. How long did he reign for? And the time that Solomon reigned in Jerusalem over all Israel was 40 years. Exactly the same. Not 39, not 40, 45 or 28. Exactly the same. His son reigned for 40 years as well. And Solomon slept with his fathers and was buried in the city of David. His father and Rehoboam, his son, reigned in his stead. Yeah. The next instance of 40 years, this is not 40 days, but 40 years we're focusing on at the moment, is Isaac. For some reason, it comes up again. And Isaac was 40 years old when he took Rebekah to wife, the daughter of Bethuel, the Syrian of Padan Aram, the sister to Laban the Syrian. He was 40 years of age. Just another coincidence, isn't it? And Isaac, again, is another important name, isn't it? You always hear it all the time. The God of Abraham, Isaac and Jacob. Those three names, they always come up all the time. So that's why I included this one. David, he was the blue-eyed boy, wasn't he? He was the one that, I think there's a Bible quote saying that he was after God's own heart. You know, he was, and I think he was his favorite. I think he was. So just to prove a point with this Isaac, how important he is, I've got three Bible verses here that mention Abraham, Isaac and Jacob. And they were paramount in the early days. Here's the first one. This is Genesis 50:24. And Joseph said unto his brethren, I die, and God will surely visit you and bring you out of this land unto the land which he sware to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. And we're going to Exodus 2:24. And God hearing their groaning, and God remembered his covenant with Abraham, with Isaac, and with Jacob. And we go into Exodus, and it comes up again. Exodus 3:6. Moreover, he said, I am the God of thy father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon God. And I could go on. It goes on throughout the Bible. There's a whole list of these things here. But that is the importance of this. It's the bloodline, isn't it? The bloodline and 40 years. And it's something which I think we're starting to reveal now, is when you get into the bloodline of things, I think the bloodline and this 40 years starts to kick in. Because if you take this David, the youngest son of Jesse. Where does that come up? That's in the next section. I'm going to show you the son, the youngest son of Jesse. This Jesse and David is the bloodline that is incredibly important. And I think this 40 years, it seems to come up for those that are in the in that bloodline. So what I'm going to do now is just branch away from 40 days, 40 nights and 40 years and just prove that this seems to be something that manifests itself in the bloodline. And the bloodline is mentioned many times throughout the Bible. But if we go into Isaiah 11:1, this is one of the mentions. This is before Jesus even arrived and was born in the New Testament. This is a long time before there's mention of Jesus here, and it's all a bit vague the way it's said, but I'll read it. This is Isaiah 11:1, and there shall come forth a rod out of the stem of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. Now Jesse was the father of David. And if we go into Jeremiah, roots is a key word here. You need to remember that, and branch. Yeah, and the stem of Jesse. Jesse, branch, roots, stem as well. Yeah. If we go to Jeremiah, this is prophecy again. This is forecasting the arrival of the Messiah again. Behold, this is Jeremiah 23:5. Behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that I will raise unto David a righteous branch, and a king shall reign and prosper, and shall execute judgment and justice in the earth. Yeah, this is all the Old Testament. If we go into Revelation 5:5, this is where the seals are opened. Well, this is just before the seals are opened. And they couldn't, there was nobody worthy to open the seals apart from one person. And this verse sums it up. Revelation 5:5. And one of the elders saith unto me, weep not, behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the root of David, hath prevailed to open the book and to loose the seven seals thereof. Yeah. And that is the Lamb, and that is Jesus, isn't it? And there's a final mention in the closing chapters of Revelation. This is about three or four chapters from the end. Revelation 22:16. These are the words of, he's returned. There's the millennial kingdom. This is, I think it's after the millennial kingdom. This is eternity, I suppose, when the new Jerusalem comes down from heaven, isn't it? Revelation 22:16, these are in red. It's the words of Jesus himself. I, Jesus, have sent mine angel to testify unto you these things in the churches. I am the root and the offspring of David and the bright and morning star. That's him confirming what was said in Isaiah. A branch shall grow out of his roots. And Jeremiah, I'll raise a righteous branch. And then in Revelation, the root of David. And then finally, he says it himself. I am the root and the offspring of David. So when you look at this, you think, if David ruled for 40 years and his son ruled for 40 years, then there seems to be something about this bloodline that determines that you may have to go through this either 40 years or 40 days and nights or both in some shape or form. But that's just my theory. This theory proves correct that it's the bloodline that seems to carry this 40 days or 40 years. Let's have a look at Jesus himself in the New Testament. So I've got four verses here. Two are covering the same thing. Basically, this one will be covering when he goes into the wilderness. Yeah. And we'll see the duration, how long he was out there for. This one in Acts will look at the resurrection and how long he was on earth before he finally departed. Yeah. He was seen, wasn't he, for a number of days. We'll see what that was. And then finally there is, this is before, just a couple of days before he is actually crucified, he mentions something, a prophecy to the disciples, to obviously Matthew and Mark. They were there and they give their accounts of it. So what I'll do is I'll start off with Matthew 4, 1 and 2. Then was Jesus led up of the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, he was afterward an hungered. Yeah. So he went out into the wilderness. How long for? 40 days and 40 nights. And he was tempted by the devil. This was just before he started his ministry, yeah? He did this first. If we go into Acts, this is after the crucifixion, and this is the resurrection. And it gives details of what happened here. Let's read it. Acts 1:3. To whom also he showed himself. Yeah, he's come back from the grave, hasn't he? To whom also he showed himself alive after his passion by many infallible proofs, being seen of them 40 days, and speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God. And then he departed, didn't he? So after his death, his resurrection, he was around for 40 days. It says it there, doesn't it? Not 39, not 42, not 24 or 28. 40 days. If we go into the next, these two verses here are related. This is just before he was crucified. And this is very important. This is Matthew 24:21. Basically, this was after the Olivet Discourse, and he's talking to the disciples, and they ask him, basically, you know, when will we know when he's, you know, it'll be the second coming? And he starts to tell them. So I'll just read these verses. And Jesus went out and departed from the temple, and his disciples came to him for to show him the buildings of the temple. This is the temple in Jerusalem, yeah? And Jesus said unto them, see ye not all these things? Verily I say unto you, there shall not be left here one stone upon another that shall not be thrown down. Yeah, so basically what he's saying, that temple will come down. Yeah, if we go to Mark, it'll be destroyed. It's the same thing again. Well, I'll read this one. And as he went out of the temple, one of his disciples saith unto him, Master, see what manner of stones and what buildings are here. And Jesus answering said unto him, seest thou these great buildings? There shall not be left one stone upon another, there shall be not thrown down. Yeah. Now, he got crucified. This is highly debatable, the exact date. But if we take, he got crucified, say, 30 AD or thereabouts. He's talking about the destruction of the Temple of Jerusalem by the Romans, isn't he? And what happens? In 70 AD, the temple was destroyed, wasn't it? If we take 70 AD and take 30 AD off, what have we got? It's 40 years again, isn't it? The number 40. And it just keeps coming up all the time. I mean, this one is not so accurate. It could be, some say he was crucified 33 AD, so it'd be 37 years, isn't it? But it gives you an idea that this theme, like a lot of things in the Bible, they do keep running through, and not just in the Old Testament. You know, they come through into the New Testament. And it's back to that stem of Jesse, isn't it? Jesus is the stem of Jesse, and basically he's the branch, but he is linked to that Old Testament. He's linked to it, isn't he? So all the things that they went through, if all the old big names went through some form of 40 days and 40 nights or 40 years, then it's guaranteed if he's on the same bloodline, he's going to go through it as well, isn't he? So if we go back to the early days of the Bible, we go back to Genesis and the flood. And I covered this 7 days. That's something that keeps coming up as well. But here we see mention of 40 days again. And it's mentioned a number of times in this Genesis 7. So whenever things are repeated, I tend to take notice. So let's have a read of this. Genesis 7:4. This is just before the flood. For yet 7 days, and I will cause it to rain upon the earth, 40 days and 40 nights, and every living substance that I have made will I destroy from off the face of the earth. And then further down, he repeats himself, well, it's repeated, Genesis 7:12, and the rain was upon the earth 40 days and 40 nights. That's the confirmation. And then it comes up again, Genesis 7:17, and the flood was 40 days upon the earth, and the waters increased and bare up the ark, and it was lift up above the earth. So 3 times it's mentioned there. And again, why 40 days? Why not 38 or 42? Or it just, it doesn't, if it's 42 days, I can understand it's 6 weeks, isn't it? But 40 days and 40 nights, it just doesn't, it's an even number, and it's 4 times 10, but I can't see what the actual relevance of it is. But if we go further down into times of Moses, this is when he went to Mount Sinai. Yeah, and if you ever read of this, the same thing again. Exodus 24:18, and Moses went into the midst of the cloud and gat him up into the mount, that's Mount Sinai, and Moses was in the mount 40 days and 40 nights. And then if we go to Exodus 34:28, he did this twice, I think. Yeah, he went up there. And there's Exodus 34:28 again. And he was there with the Lord, this is Moses, 40 days and 40 nights. He did neither eat bread nor drink water, and he wrote upon the tables the words of the covenant, the Ten Commandments. That's the tablets of stone, isn't it? And here's some closing verses that demonstrate, they're quite wide and varied, but they all mention 40 years or 40 somewhere anyway. And we'll just read these. Most of these are in the Old Testament. The first one is Numbers 32:13. And the Lord's anger was kindled against Israel, and he made them wander in the wilderness 40 years until all the generation that had done evil in the sight of the Lord was consumed. Again, it's all extreme stuff, isn't it? If we go into Judges, the children of Israel again. And the children of Israel did evil again in the sight of the Lord, and the Lord delivered them into the hand of the Philistines 40 years. Not 10, not 20, not 50 or 30, but 40 years. If we go into Ezekiel 4:6, and this is something that Ezekiel had to do. He had to bear the iniquity and the sin of Judah. And this is what he had to do. And when thou hast accomplished them, lie again on their right side, and thou shalt bear the iniquity of the house of Judah 40 days. I have appointed thee each day for a year. Again, you see, it's that 40 years. And this, again, ties up what I was saying in another video, is a day is equivalent to a year in prophecy. Yeah. If we go into 1 Kings 19:7, this is Elijah. And the angel of the Lord came again the second time and touched him and said, arise and eat, because the journey is too great for thee. And he arose and did eat and drink, and went in the strength of that meat 40 days and 40 nights unto Horeb, the mount of God. So this angel fed him angel food, I suppose, really, isn't it? And after that, he didn't eat for 40 days and 40 nights. Again, Elijah, one of the big names, had to go through this fast again. It's this bloodline thing, isn't it? And finally, we go into Ezekiel 29:13. This is the desolation of Egypt. Ezekiel 29:11. No foot of man shall pass through it, nor foot of beast shall pass through it, neither shall it be inhabited 40 years. And I'll make the land of Egypt desolate in the midst of the countries that are desolate, and her cities among the cities that are laid waste shall be desolate 40 years. And I will scatter the Egyptians among the nations, and will disperse them through the countries. Yet thus saith the Lord God, at the end of 40 years will I gather the Egyptians from the people whither they were scattered. So in summary, what can we say about this 40 days, 40 nights and 40 years? Is it just a number that comes up a number of times in the Bible but doesn't really mean anything? Or does it mean something else? I think if you actually look at the times it came up, David was one of the, he was the blue-eyed boy, wasn't he? That was after God's heart. And he wasn't perfect, he did stray. But he was about as close as he got to with human flesh, really, isn't it? Solomon was in favour, but he fell out of favour near the end. He started going to the high places and worshipping idols and all the rest of it, isn't it? But he ruled for 40 years as well, and he was the bloodline from David. And if you take Exodus, Moses, he brought down the law, the Ten Commandments. And that was 40 days and 40 nights as well, wasn't it? And then if you take the flood, that was 40 days and 40 nights. And then Jesus in the wilderness, that was 40 days and 40 nights. And he fasted as well. It's, I would say in summary, it is a form of testing, a form of suffering, I suppose, a form of transformation, a form of change, going from one stage to another, a form of possibly purification, a challenge, that sort of thing. I think that's what it is. And it seems to be prevalent in a particular bloodline. Isaac, he came under that 40-year rule as well, wasn't it? So it is something that marks it's also sort of like an interim period as well, isn't it? Like Jesus, when he was resurrected, he was floating around, appearing alive, but he was sort of resurrected, wasn't he? And that lasted for 40 days before he went up to heaven, doesn't it? But and also his prophecy, he said it roughly around about 30 AD, and it actually came into fruition in 70 AD or thereabouts. So again, 40 years. So he did the 40 years and the 40 days and 40 nights. So I think it is a form of transformation, a form of testing, and a form of monumental change. Yeah. And finally, I'm going to go on to basically Revelation, the book of Revelation. That is got to be the ultimate test, challenge, change that is coming, isn't it? It's the end times, the last days. And I've researched this. I'm not going to put any Bible quotes up here or go through it, but I mean, it just doesn't come up at all. It's not mentioned once. 40 days or 40 nights. I'm just putting it in the software now and we'll see what it comes up. It comes up absolutely stacks of stuff, but I'm just going through. You can see, if you look on the left hand pane here, Genesis, Exodus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, Judges, 1 Samuel, 1 Kings, Ezekiel, Jonah, Maccabees, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, and Acts. And that's it. It's not mentioned in Revelation. I mean, if we do a search and just change it to 40, yeah, the number 40, you'll come up with even more stuff. Yeah, anything resembling 40, and then we come up with, look, Genesis, Exodus, absolutely stacks. But it's all in order. Judges, Kings, Chronicles, Ezra and Nehemiah, goes all the way through Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts, and there is. But it's what you'll find is it's not the number on its own. Let's have a look at this one. Revelation, see, 40 and 4,000, 40 and 2 months, 40 and 2 months, 40 and 4,000, 40 and 4,000, 40 and 4 cubits. So the number 40 is mentioned over 140 times in the Bible, and it seems to be a God-chosen number to represent a period of hardship, trial, testing, or a probationary period, or a period of irreversible change. It also seems to be a time period that is significantly related to fasting for some reason. It could possibly signify a chrysalis period from caterpillar to butterfly, a sort of transformation which seems particularly relevant in relation to its mention in the New Testament and Jesus quite a number of times. And that's what I'm saying. When you get into it, if you're running a ministry, if you are preaching or prophesying, that sort of thing, then I think it is something that you may want to take on board, that you may have to do. Because if you are talking as Jesus talked, then you have to be walking as he walked as well. And he did 40 days and 40 nights before he started his ministry. And if you or anybody else or myself, we are representatives of Christ, then really we should have to go through that same thing as well, isn't it? It's something to think about anyway. But it's amazing, the Bible, you know, when you get into it, you approach it with a question and it will give you answers, you know. But I think, as I keep saying, you have to approach the Bible with an open mind and let it present what it's trying to say, and don't arrive with preconceived notions, and certainly don't arrive with assumptions. You know, and it's very easy to get assumptions by reading stuff on other websites, isn't it, out there, and also, you know, watching YouTube videos, especially all this end time stuff. From my experience, I mean, me, I just don't watch the stuff anymore now. I've got to keep a clear mind, and I just read the Bible, and it's just a couple of people I follow, and I use them for advice. But, you know, you've got to, everything you listen to, and including myself, you've got to check against the Spirit, or check with the Spirit. And you've got to check against the Word, haven't you, every time. But as I keep saying, these are just my views, opinions, and what I'm saying here is not preaching, it's not prophecy, it's just a Bible prophecy analysis, and that's all it is really. But it's amazing, just by looking at the number 40 days, 40 nights, or 40 years, it's amazing the journey it can take you, and it just shows that the Bible, it is interconnected all the way through, especially when you go to that the David, the youngest son of Jesse. When you go along that route and you take David and the bloodline going backwards, and then you also take it going forwards, and there's mention in Isaiah, Jeremiah, all the way through the Bible, there's mention of this branch or root of David, and which at the end Jesus says it himself. He reveals it right, this is about 3 or 4 chapters. Look, this is the end verses here, yeah, and this is it here, the final one. He says, I Jesus have sent mine angel to testify unto you these things in the churches. I am the root and the offspring of David and the bright and morning star. Confirmation of Jeremiah, Isaiah, and everything else that's mentioned in the Old Testament. But it's a mystery to me why the number 40 is not mentioned in Revelation at all. It may come up as 144,000. That's the Jewish, isn't it? That mentioned, there's the multitude and the 144,000. But there's no actual 40 days, 40 nights. None of that is mentioned at all. Yeah, and you think that it sounds like a transformatory period, isn't it? But the number that comes up most in Revelation is the number 7. That's the one that came up, and you have to watch the seventh seal of Revelation. If you watch that video, that goes into great detail on the appearance of the number 7, how many times it actually comes up, and the meaning of the seventh seal. That's another interesting video again. And on a final note, this is nothing to do with the number 40 or 40 days, 40 nights, or even 40 years. This is the third verse in Revelation 1. Yeah, and it's something I think you need to bear in mind. I've forgotten all about this. I found this on my travels. I think I was on YouTube watching somebody, I think, which is quite rare these days. I don't really watch much stuff on YouTube. But and he came up with this verse, and I'm going to read it. Blessed is he that readeth, and they that hear the words of this prophecy, and keep those things which are written therein, for the time is at hand. And I think that's something you need to, certainly in this day and age, stick that on a wall somewhere. Stick it in front of your shaving mirror, or that sort of thing. But certainly, blessed is he that readeth, and they that hear the words. And that's how I'm going to end this video. And I've got a new line now. I'm going to say to people, instead of be safe and be prepared, I'm going to say be blessed. And I shall catch you in the next video.